Maya Adkins, or Judah Adkins, and I just want to welcome you again today to the program, How Big is God? And I just want to remind you that to go to my website and to read some other articles and to watch the other videos. And we've been talking about the love of God and to have a love revolution. And so it's important that we find out what the love of God is, correct? Well, I had, the last time we were together, I shared with you 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I began to share that chapter with you, and I had spoken to you and said that it's important to go to this chapter because of the fact that it will tell you what the love of God is and what God's character is. God's character is wrapped up in His love. That is what, when you are born again, and you accept Him into your life, you no longer belong to this world. I think I gave you the wrong scripture the last time we were together. It's 1 Corinthians 6:20. For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So once you are God's, you belong to God, then you want to have the character of God. You want to build into your life that love, because it is Him, and that what governs His system. You don't belong to the world system anymore. You belong to God's system, and that system is run and is governed by the love of God. And Jesus spoke in 1 John, I believe it's chapter 14, and told you to love the Lord thy God with all your might, with all your soul, with everything that's in you, basically, your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And all the laws of the prophet hang on that one law. Because when you love, you're not going to do things to hurt people, harm people. You want to do your best. You want to serve God with all your heart and walk uprightly before Him. And therefore, you will walk toward people with the same mind and heart, won't you? Okay, the last time we were together, I began sharing with you, if I was a pastor of a church, and I had developed in all the gifts, I prophesied, I would go on the mission field, I seen blind eyes open, I would see people healed, limbs grow, I operated in the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, and I mean, I was used mightily. But then I come back home and I am harsh toward my family. I'm harsh toward my children. I'm harsh toward my fellow associates in my church or whatever. And I'm short. I'm not, you know, I don't ask people to do things. Maybe I demand them to do things. What would you say about me, I ask you? I hope that you would say that that person has not developed the love of God. And that would be correct. I had not developed the love of God. I could give my body to be burned. I could do all the things that I see. I have faith to move mountains. But I've got to have love, the love of God. That's what 1 Corinthians shares with us. Because if we do not have the love of God, it says we are nothing. Now, we want to start talking about what love is. And I'm going to use the Amplified Bible. It's a great little Bible. It's an expanded edition. It's a good study Bible. I study the King James, but I also look at other translations. I always have for years. And sometimes words that are used in the King James, like edify, we don't use those words. We use the word build up. We can understand that more in our speech today. But I don't study Bibles that take away from the Word of God. There is Bibles out there that take away from the Word of God. They translate it down till it's so weak. And we don't want to study those kind of translations. But I stick with strong translations. And Amplified Bible is a good one. It doesn't change the wording, and it just expands. So let's start. It says, love endures long and is patient and kind. Love is never is never Love never is envious or boils over with jealousy. Let's stop right here for a minute. Now, we know jealousy is cruel as the grave, the Bible says. Jealousy can hurt a lot of people. There's two words in the Greek that actually shares what love is. Phileo is the natural human kind of love. And agape is used for the true love of God. Now, phileo love is the natural love. It's a selfish love. It's a love that leads to the divorce court. It's a love that's not very patient with you. He may stick with you for a little bit, but it doesn't have much endurance. But the true love of God will stick with you through anything and everything, because that is the character of God. So now God, he said that he was jealous over us, but that's different. It's a jealousy. He doesn't want to see you serving other gods because he created you and I. And he's jealous over us when we let things become gods in our lives. When we let sports and activities come before him, he becomes jealous over us. So that's a different kind. But a jealousy that is of the world is a cruel jealousy. A jealousy that can hurt people when is allowed to have its reign. So anyways, let's get back to it. It says, it is not boastful or vainglorious. It does not display itself haughtily. It is not conceited, arrogant, inflated with pride. Now we know pride can be a very bad thing, because we can become so proud that we just think we are all it, you know, that we're all it in a bag of chips, which is not true. Pride will keep us from being humble and helping people. It'll keep us from straightening out situations that need to be straightened out, because pride wants to be right. Pride doesn't want to be wrong. So we need to let go of pride, don't we? Pride will keep you from doing for other people, because you're afraid somebody might see you do something for somebody that's hurting, and maybe they're just not in your group or whatever. And so you won't do it because you're afraid of what they're going to say, or you won't be popular. Well, is that vain or what? That is so vain. And that is not the love of God, nor pleasing, or has nothing to do with the love of God. So pride in that way, now there's pride that we do a good job and we can be proud, but not to the place that it takes preeminence over everything else. That can even be bad, can't it? Okay, it goes on, it is not rude, unmannerly, and does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights or its own way, or for it is not self-seeking. Well, we can see today that we live in a generation that is going to have their own way regardless of what we say or do. They want to be right. They have their causes, and they're going to stand by their causes, whether it hurts you or it hurts me. They want to stand up and say that they're right about things when they know really inside they're dead wrong about them. But they're so self-centered and self-seeking that they will have their way regardless, even if it hurts someone else. And this is devilish and evil. And that is the kind of situation that can cause such hurt to a nation. And we can see that it is. It is not a giving. It doesn't want to give. It wants their way about it, regardless of what they have to do to get it. And it goes on to say, it is not touchy or fretful or resentful. Now, if you're a person that is touchy and fretful all the time and resentful, it's hard for people to get along with you, isn't it? Or people kind of shy away from you, because if they're afraid that they're going to say something that you're going to get upset about, and then we have this full conversation about you and how that someone's hurt you. And you're resentful when you're resentful, or you live in that state of where you're fretful and you're worried all the time, it's also you don't listen well because you're so caught up in what's going on in the now and in the situation that anything anybody says, it's very easy for you to misunderstand what they're trying to say to you and take it wrong, and then you build on that. And so then you compile another, you become hurt, and then you compile more hurt on it to the place that you're a person that is so caught up in yourself. And it's very selfish, isn't it? Because it's all about you at that moment. It's somebody's hurt you. Somebody said the wrong things to you, and you can't seem to see outside of yourself. So people will steer away from you, and people will not want to hang with you because of those reasons, will they? And you know, the Bible says for us to seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his way of doing things, and all things will be added unto you. Whatever you need will be added unto you. So when we're fretful, we're worried to the point that we're so concerned about our lives that we're not trusting God with our lives. And that we have to trust God. We have to learn to walk with God daily. We can't worry for tomorrow because tomorrow we can't even begin to guess what will happen. But God knows. So we leave it in his hands. Okay, and it says it does not, it's not resentful. It takes no account of the evil done to it, and it pays no attention to a suffered wrong. Now, people do things wrong all the time. And you know, if we're in the state I was just sharing with you, we want to point out to them how wrong they are all the time and how you've suffered a wrong. But when you walk in the love of God, you get to the place where you put those things on the shelf. You're not worried about that anymore. You have given it to God, and God will straighten those things out. And you don't have to pay attention to all the every little thing that happens to you. You don't have to have the last word on every little thing that happens to you. Let it go. Be a grown up in the room. And don't point out everybody's faults. And when they start try to point yours out, just say, "Oh well, you know, yes, I'm not perfect. But you know, God loves me," or whatever makes you maintain yourself and holds your composure in the love of God. And the you know, the more you practice the love of God, the better you get at it. And the more love will take hold of you, the more love begins to possess you, God's love. So, anyways, God's love to you is like flowers to a mountainside. You see all the imperfections in a mountainside you might pass by, and there's rugged places and ruts. But the next time you go by, here's these great big beautiful flowers, and they've covered all the ruts, and you can't see the imperfections. And that's the way we are. 1 Peter 4:8 says, "And above all things, have fervent charity." Love. Fervent means to have an earnest, sincere love toward one another among yourselves. For charity shall cover the multitude of sins. And it does. When you walk in love, there might be things you do wrong, but people can kind of overlook them sometimes because, and most of the time, because you know why? They know your character is to truly walk in love. And when you hurt somebody, they've seen you go back and say, "You know, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have done that." And so when you live in that kind of life, people begin to just say, "You know what? They must not feel well today. There must have been something happened." They excuse that because they know that you have a true heart of love, and that love covers a multitude of sins. And it says it does not rejoice at injustice and unrighteousness. Oh boy. We don't laugh when somebody gets hurt. When we know there's been an injustice done, we want to pray about that. We want to see that person come through that. We want to see that person, the situation made right on their behalf. when we stand by and we see people hurt and we see misunderstandings said, and we've been a witness to it, and we let those things go and let that person be hurt over the situation, or maybe even fired up in a job, but we know in our hearts it was not their fault, and we stand by and we see an injustice done to that person, would that be the love of God? Absolutely not. You know that wouldn't be the love of God. So we want to walk in righteousness. We want to be upright in what we say and do. And we want to look out for the better for someone else's good. That's the true love of God. It's not looking out for number one. It's looking out for your brother's good or another person's good. If you see something that you know that you can do to help a person and you don't help them, the Bible says, how can the love of God dwell in you? When you have this world's goods and you know you can help a person, but you don't help them, then how can you say you have the love of God? You can't. So, you know, again, the more we practice the love of God, the better we get at it, and the more love takes us over, and the more skillful we become at it. And then knowledge, and when we gain knowledge, knowledge kicks into those things, and we begin to handle things altogether different than what we would have a few years ago. We see that we can go about things in a different way and approach people in different ways, that we can approach a person, not tell them how bad they are because they've made a mistake, but that we can begin to say to them, you know, how can I help you? How can we do this differently? So we have an opportunity every day. I wrote a paper on, if you go on my website, How Big Is God? I wrote a paper, Hello World. And in that paper, I give a 30-day challenge of a husband and wife. You know, we can be so touchy, self-seeking, fretful, and resentful, even in our marriages. Nobody wants to put one another first anymore. It's all about me. It's about what I want, not what you want. And that's not the love of God. But if we will begin, you say your husband wants to divorce you, your wife wants to divorce you, I promise you, if you'll take this 30-day challenge and you will begin to bend over backwards to show that other person love, bring them flowers, husbands, bring your wives flowers, begin to speak love words, begin to help out in the household. You don't have to be asked. Do things that will bless them and help them. Refuse to say bad words to them. Admit when you're wrong and do it in front of your children. Because I'm telling you, that speaks volumes. When your actions in front of your children and even in front of your wife, that even when you're wrong with your children, you correct yourself. Take that challenge, and I promise you, you will see things change in your household that will be unbelievable. And you begin to take a back seat to saying, you know, that you always have to have the first and last words. You begin to just say, oh, well, I did that wrong, and yes, you're right. And yes, you know, I didn't give you a chance. I've been rude. I've been inconsiderate. I haven't come home when I needed to. I haven't been patient with you, and forgive me. These are things in every relationship, not only in a husband and wife, but in a working relationship at your office, on the job, wherever you might be. If you will begin to really have the love of God and practice the love of God, you can turn so many things around in your life, and it will be such a blessing to you, and it will come back to you. I promise you, it will come back to you. Well, I'm not going to go any longer today. I want you to know that God's love is the greatest thing that we can ever have or possess. And I just pray right now in Jesus' name that He opens the eyes of your understanding to show you that you can have a life of joy, not just happiness. Happiness is a part of that natural human kind of love. But you can have a lasting joy in your life to see people blessed and helped. And it will turn your life around in such ways and give you such satisfaction. And I pray that God shows and manifests these things to you, and that you have a lovely day. And that until I see you again, I just pray that you give the love of God a chance in your life. Well, God bless you. I'll see you next time. Bye.